Hi, welcome to the podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. We are continuing our Unit 1, the concept of education, and our topic of conversation is nature and scope of education, cross-cultural perspective. We have already read in the previous pages that the concept of education is not monolithic or uniform across cultures and periods of history. Educational ideas are known to have developed out of the human struggle for survival and enlightenment. The educational heritage of the Western civilization has greatly influenced American education. World educational history has, however, also benefited greatly from Mesoamerican, African, and Asian civilization. The Mayans of Mexico, Yucatan Peninsula, and Guatemala developed expertise in the fields of architect and astronomy. Equally specialized was a type of writing based on word signs or logographs, which the Mayan priests taught their apprentices in the religious schools. Similarly, the Chinese developed an elaborate educational system which was based on Confucian philosophy. Civil servants who administered the Chinese Empire were those who passed the formal examination. Education is, however, not confined to developing expertise in world science or architecture and astronomy as the Mayan, or preparing people to rule the state as civil servant through an examination system as the Chinese did. The indigenous people or tribal communities also developed skills for survival and a way of transmitting the language, skill, knowledge, belief, and values to their children, which prepares them for adult role. Those who subsist by hunting and gathering teach their boys to make weapons and their girls to collect food from forests. Similarly, those who subsist by cultivating teach their children to prepare the earth, sow, transplant, and harvest the grain. These are not isolated activities, rather, they are interrelated with the entire way of life. Knowledge, belief, arts, morals, and customs of the community. In the absence of the written text and the formal schooling, the transmission of information and cultural wisdom takes place through oral tradition. It is through songs, legends, and stories, proverbs, and riddles narrated by the elders that the children learn about the group's history, wars, victories, and defeats and heroes. These were the non-formal ways of preparation for adulthood. As a useful member of society among indigenous people who were not exposed to the formal system of education in schools, many sociologists believe that they were in no way less refined or inferior to those who passed through the formal education system. Now, let us move to the point, education in ancient Greece. Ancient Greece is treated as the epicenter of Western culture. It is important to understand how and what kind of knowledge was transmitted there. As we know, Homer's poem provided Greeks a means of defining their cultural identity, since they explain Greeks' origin, portray their struggles, and provide a model for future. Children who study the behavior of the epic heroes learn the characteristics and qualities that make life worth living. The behaviors expected of warrior knights and the flaws or weaknesses in human character that brought harm to oneself and one's friend. Greeks laid greater emphasis on participation of children in culture than on formal schooling. Athenian believed that liberal education was needed by an individual to discharge duties towards the state and for self-development. Since slaves were required to serve the masters, they were kept away from liberal education. Instead, they were trained in skills for specific trades. In Athens, women had no legal or economic rights. The vast majority of them were excluded from formal education. Girls in Sparta were, however, more exposed to schooling. Here, the thrust was on athletic training that would prepare them for healthy motherhood to future spectrum soldiers. In the middle of the 5th century BC, the commercial class began to take over the landed as aristocrats. Consequently, traditional ideas about education came to be diluted. This led to the rise of a group of professional educators who came to be known as the Sophists. The Sophists were wandering teachers who specialized in teaching grammar, logic, and rhetoric. They instructed all those who could afford to pay them. Education no longer remained confined to the select group of people who was made available to much larger number of people, leading to socio-economic mobility. Now, let us move our conversation to the next point, education in ancient Rome. In ancient Rome, education was aimed at raising politician and able administrators. It was reserved for those who could afford to pay for it and had the time to attend school. Children belonging to poor family could not attend school, rather they were taken as workers. Most of the children of the slaves were trained to perform certain tasks. They were denied education. Girls of upper classes learned to read and write at home, while the boys attending primary schools, later secondary schools, in which they learnt Latin and Greek grammar. The educational ideal of Rome was the orator. An orator was a well-educated man in public life. He could be a senator, lawyer, teacher, civil servant, or a politician. A great orator was one who won debates and arguments in a forum. Cicero was a distinguished Roman senator who was well versed in Greek and Latin grammar, literature, history, and rhetoric. He believed that the educational ideas should have command over astronomy, ethics, geography, history, law, medicine, military science, natural science, philosophy, and psychology. Knowledge of these disciplines helped him in many ways. For example, developing and presenting an argument, engaging with the emotions of the audience, and influencing public affairs. Now, let us move to the next point, education in Middle Ages. In the Middle Ages or the medieval period, European education was imparted in institutions associated with the church. the elementary, parish, chantry and monastic schools. The knights received training in military affairs and in chivalric code of behavior in places. Monastic and cathedral school, however, followed the general studies curriculum at the secondary level. There were some schools that provided basic education along with training for a trade. These were maintained not only by the church but by merchants and craft guides. Most of the learners in schools were those who planned to embark on religious life as priests, monks and clerics. The serfs confined their activities to the estate of feudal lords as agricultural workers. By the 11th century, the scholastic tradition emphasizing the spirit of the inquiry, scholarship and teaching set in. Faith and reasons were identified as complementary sources of truth. In fact, the teaching clerics, better known as scholastic, believed that God's words were revealed in the sacred scriptures and in the writings of church fathers. They also accepted the importance of human reason. In scholastic schools, the disciplines of logic, mathematics, natural and moral philosophy, metaphysics and theology were taught as part of a higher education. The education encouraged inculcation of deductive reasoning among learners. Over a period of time, the number of students enrolled in cathedral schools far exceeded their capacity. As a result, universities were established to impart higher education. Since the basic constituent of knowledge was believed to be the authority of the scriptures, medieval universities emerged as centers of theology. A high level of scholarship, however, developed in secular disciplines too. The universities set up professional schools of law, medicine, along with theology. These were in addition to the liberal arts. There is no denying that education in the Middle Ages was formal, organized and institutionalized to a large extent. Now let us move to the next point. Education in the Renaissance period. In the Renaissance period, the scholastic model was challenged. The cleric who was trained in scholastic logic was not longer regarded as representing an educated person. Instead, the courtier who were liberally educated in classical literature, a capable diplomat, a man of style and elegance, was treated as a model to be emulated by children. Education now basically consisted of learning classical Greek and Latin literature. The aim was not merely to teach the nuances of logic, but to develop the all-round personality of the individual. It was in Italy that the effect of the Renaissance was most clearly marked, because here the revival of commerce generated a financial surplus that was directed towards extending support to the arts, literature and architecture. The elite of the country established their identity as custodian of knowledge, while the rulers set up court schools that would impart new learning. The Renaissance humanistic identified the study of Latin as the marker of an educated person. an educated person was one who had studied classical languages and classical literature closely. The emphasis was on a human-centered conception of knowledge in which human beings were not studied as objects for scientific inquiry but indirectly through classical literature. It was later that the undue emphasis on the study of literature at the cost of experience was questioned by Rousseau, Pestrozzi, Dewey and others. Now let us move to the next point, education in the age of enlightenment. In the age of enlightenment, the reason governed education as also all other major institutions. Scientists used objective methods to formulate natural laws that established the idea that all the natural processes follow an order. The Enlightenment period encouraged rationality among people, particularly for improving their lives and solving their problems. Against this backdrop, school education was designed to develop reasoning ability in students. The major challenge before teachers in school was to cultivate the spirit to raise questions among students and the willingness to apply scientific and empirical methods of inquiry in understanding social reality. Enlightenment marked the creation of an education system based on equality, individualism, and intellectual reasoning. Here we want to close this lecture. Thank you so much for choosing this podcast.